Welcome to Learn Yourself. Today we are going to learn question answers from the final exercise. This is under CBSE standard 9 syllabus. So the first question of the final exercise is it possible for the object to be traveling with a non-zero velocity? Non-zero velocity means the object has some of the velocity. That is the meaning of non-zero velocity. Non-zero means it has some velocity. So is it possible for object to be traveling with a non-zero velocity means is it possible for an object to travel with certain velocity? If yes, state the condition that must be placed on the magnitude and direction of the velocity. If that object has to continue doing so in the same direction with the same velocity, then what all are the conditions? If no, provide a reason. And if that object is not been able to do so, that it should continue to move in that direction. If that object will not be able to do so, then what all are the reasons? Now we know that when any ball is rolling on the ground, it will keep on doing the same thing until and unless some external unbalanced force will act upon that. That means if there is a no friction of the ground, then the ball will continue to move in that direction in forever. Forever it will continue to move in that direction with the same velocity. But there will be always, practically there will be always a friction. So because of the friction, eventually it is going to stop. So this situation we need to explain here. That yes, object can travel with non-zero velocity when net external force is zero. So here we are trying to say that when there is no external unbalanced force, two things should be there. First, external force should be there, and second, unbalanced force should be there. Balanced force will not show any result, so it has to be unbalanced. So it will stop the motion, eventually it will stop the motion. Object is moving in certain direction. So now we are explaining the reason that object is moving in certain direction with certain velocity, will continue to do so. Why we have written here direction? Because if a ball is in a motion or object is in a motion, if we want to change only a direction, then also we have to apply force. So that's why I have mentioned here certain direction. That object is moving in certain direction with certain velocity, will continue to do so until unbalanced external force will be applicable on it. If we want to change either of this means any of this we want to change, then we need to apply some external unbalanced force. Then only we will be able to change one of this or both of this. Second question, when a carpet is beaten with a stick, dust comes out of it. What is the reason behind this? So the reason is dust particles will be on the carpet. The carpet and the dust particle both will be in a resting position. When we are beating a carpet will get a jerk, but the dust particle which has settled on it will not get a jerk, and they'll be in their resting position and they will continue to do so because of their inertia. So carpet will move from its position, but the dust particle will not move from its position. So they both will get separated from each other and dust particles will come out of it. Now how can we write this? Dust particles will be on the carpet in resting position. When the carpet is beaten, carpet will move, it will get jerk, but dust will remain at their position due to their inertia. Hence it will get separated from the carpet, it will come out, and this happens because of their resting position, and they will continue to do so until the external unbalanced force will be applicable on it. Third question is, Why is it advised to tie any luggage kept on the roof of the bus with a rope? That means we should always tie our luggage on the roof of the bus. Why? Because when bus is in the moving condition, the luggage also is in the motion along with the bus. And when bus suddenly stops or when bus suddenly apply the brake, at that time the luggage will continue and luggage will remain in the motion because of its inertia. At that time luggage may fall from the roof of the bus, and in this situation luggage may fall at the front or in the forward direction. But in another situation, when bus will suddenly starts moving, at that time luggage will be at the resting position and it will remain and it will continue to do so until an external unbalance force will be applicable on that. So in that situation, when bus will suddenly start moving, luggage may fall at the backward direction. So this should not happen. That's why it is advisable that we should always tie our luggage which we are placing on the roof of the bus. So here, while the bus is moving, the luggage tend to remain in the motion due to its inertia. When bus is moving, along with that luggage is also moving and it will continue to do so because of its inertia. When bus suddenly stops but the luggage will remain in the motion, so it may fall from the roof. To avoid this situation, it is advisable that luggage should be tied on the roof, or luggage we should keep it safely or tied completely on the roof. The other situation also you can describe, that when it will suddenly start, it may fall backward because of its resting inertia. Fourth question is, a batsman hits a cricket ball which then rolls on a level ground. After covering a short distance, the ball comes to rest. The ball slows to a stop because when he is hitting a ball, it will cover some of the distance on the level ground, and after that, after some period of time, it will stop. What will be the reason behind this? The batsman did not hit the ball hard enough. Velocity is proportional to the force exerted on the ball. There is a force on the ball opposing the motion. There is no unbalanced force on the ball, so ball would want to come to rest. So among this C option is correct, because there will be always an unbalanced external force acting on an object, and because of that the object will come to rest in practical situation. In ideal situation, if there is no external unbalanced force, then object will move and continue to do so forever. But this will not happen because the person has hit the ball, it has covered some distance, and eventually it will stop because of the friction force, because of the external unbalanced force applicable on that. So C is, there is a force on the ball opposing the motion. So when ball is moving in this direction, on opposite direction, the friction force will be applicable on that. This will be in opposite direction. So that's why they are saying opposing the motion, means it will be in the opposite direction of the motion. Fifth question is, a truck starts from rest and rolls down a hill with a constant acceleration. It travels a distance of 400 meter. So here distance is 400 meter in 20 seconds. So in 20 seconds it covers 400 meter. Find its acceleration. We have to find A, acceleration. Find the force acting on it if its mass is 7 ton. Now 1 ton equals to 1000 kg, which they have already given. So we have to find out the force acting on it. So here let us note down all the details what all they have given to us. So it travels a distance of 400 meter. So our distance is S equals to 400 meter. This S is denoting a distance, and this we have taken it from the chapter number 8, that S equals to 400 meter, and time is 22nd. Time is 22nd. Now we have to find its acceleration. Here they have said that a truck starts from rest. It was at the resting position. That means its initial velocity is going to be zero and then it rolls down. So we have to find out its acceleration. So A we have to find out. What is A? We do not know. To find out this, we also need final velocity, which also we do not know. And after that, we have to find out the force. But we know the distance and we know the mass. That mass equals to 7 ton. Now, if we want to convert this ton into the kg, then 1 ton equals to 1000 kg. So here it is going to be 7000 kg. 7 into 1000. So we have converted this mass into 7000 kg. Now, S equals to 400 meter is there. From the formula of the distance, we can find out the acceleration. That S equals to ut plus 1/2 at square, because we do not know here final velocity. So that's why we can use this equation. From that we are going to find out A, which is acceleration. So here u is, we know that it is 0. So 0 into t is 20 plus 1/2 into A, we do not know, and t is 20 square. Now S is 400 meter. This is going to be 400 meter. Now this term is going to be 0 because it is in multiplication with 0. So we will get here 400 equals to 20 square. So it is going to give us 400. So 400 into A, and in division 2 will be there, because here half is there. 1 divided by 2 is there. So here half is there. Now, when we are going to solve this, we will get A equals to, this 400 is in multiplication. When it will change a side, it will go to denominator. So 400 divided by 400, and in multiplication, this 2 is in denominator. Once it will go towards this side, it is going to be in the numerator. So 2. So A equals to 2 meter per second square. This is acceleration, and this is our first answer, that A equals to 2 meter per second square. Now, first answer we got it. Now we have to find out the force. So we know the formula, that F equals to M into A. From this formula we are going to find out the force. Mass we know, that is 7 ton, and we have converted it into kg. So it is 7000 kg. So 7000 kg is mass into acceleration is 2 meter per second square. 2 meter per second square. So when we are multiplying this, we will get 14000 kg meter per second square. So this is the force which is acting on that truck while it is rolling down. So this is the first answer, and this is our second answer. Sixth question. A stone of 1 kg is thrown with a velocity of 20 meter per second across the frozen surface of a lake and comes to rest after traveling a distance of 50 meter. What is the force of friction between the stone and the ice? When the lake is frozen, on top of that there will be a ice. So it's a slippery surface. So when we are throwing a stone, so it will travel horizontally on the surface of the lake. Now what all details they have given to us is the mass of the stone they have given, thrown with a velocity. So velocity of the stone they have given, across the frozen surface of lake, and it comes to rest. Rest means it will stop after some time. That means its final velocity is zero. After traveling a distance of 50 meter. So distance also they have said. What is the force of friction between the stone and the ice? So here we have to find out the force. So let us write what all details they have given to us. So mass of stone they have given. So m1 equals to 1 kg they have given. Then velocity of 20 meter per second. So velocity, that is initial velocity, that is 20 meter per second. Then distance, that is s, is 50 meter. Then it comes to rest, that means the final velocity is 0 because it is coming to rest after traveling the 50 meter. Now we have to find out the force. What will be the force? And after this force, it will eventually stop after traveling 50 meter. So to find out force, we need mass into A. We need M and A. A is our acceleration. We do not know acceleration, but from this detail, we will find out acceleration, and from that acceleration we are going to find out force. So let us first find out acceleration. So acceleration is equals to what all details they have given to us? U, V, S, we have. So our equation is 2As equals to V square minus U square. Now we want to find out acceleration. So 2 and s, that is a distance, we will take it to other side and it will go to denominator. So a equals to v square minus u square divided by 2s. Now let us put all the values. V is 0 minus u square, that is 20 square. In denominator 2 into s is 50. S is 50. So here we are going to get 400, that 2 minus, because this minus sign will be there, and 2 into 50 is 100. So we are going to get here minus 4 meter per second square. This is going to be square because this is acceleration. Acceleration's unit is meter per second square. From this we are going to find out F equals to M into A. So m is 1 kg, where a is minus 4. A is minus 4. So here we are going to get minus 4, and this is a force. So the unit of this is going to be Newton. So minus 4 Newton force will be applicable on the stone in opposite direction of the motion. So that's why the sign is negative here. Whenever any vehicle will eventually stop after applying a brake, or when any object is coming to rest after traveling for some time, then there will be a friction force applicable on that. So in that case, acceleration and force, this force will be termed as a friction force. So acceleration and force both will be in negative, because the acceleration is continuously decreasing, and that's why it will be negative, whereas force will be applicable in opposite direction of the motion. So that's why force will be negative. The seventh question. A 8000 kg engine pulls a train of 5 wagons, each of 2000 kg, along a horizontal track. If the engine exerts a force of 4000 newton and the track offers a friction force of 5000 newton, then calculate net accelerating force and acceleration of the train. Now let us first understand a situation that train is going like this on the track, and it is connected with wagons. These are wagons, and like this there are 5 wagons. There are 5 wagons over here. This is engine, and each of 2000 kg, each wagon is of 2000 kg mass. Now if the engine exerts a force of 40,000 newton, so engine's force is 40,000 newton, and that too in which direction? In forward direction. It is pulling all these wagons. There are 5 wagons out here, that 3 and 2 more. 2 more wagons are there. And like this, there are 5 wagons, and it is pulling, and it is applying 40,000 newton force in forward direction. And the track, it is traveling on the track. So that track offers a friction force in opposite direction. Friction force will be always in opposite direction. So it will come from the front and go towards the backward. Its direction will be opposite to that of the motion's direction. motion is in this direction and friction force will be in this direction. And how much it is? It is 5000 Newton. It is 5000 Newton. So 40,000 Newton force in forward direction, whereas in reverse direction 5000 Newton friction force is there. So if we want to find out that how much total force the engine is applying on all these wagons, then we need to subtract this 5000 from 40,000, because since it is in opposite direction. So total force applying by engine to the wagons is 40,000 minus 5000, because 5000 is from opposite side. So 5000 will be subtracting here, and we will get 35,000 Newton force. And this much force engine is exerting on all these 5 wagons. Engine is pulling itself also, and along with itself it is pulling 5 wagons. Now how much load it is carrying, if we want to check that, we have to multiply this, because each wagon has 2000 kg mass. So here we are going to multiply 2000 into 5. So it is 10,000 kg. So engine is 8,000 kg. Now it is pulling this 8,000 kg also. Along with this, it is pulling 10,000 kg of all these wagons. So how much weight the engine is pulling? That is 8,000 plus 10,000. So engine is pulling total 18,000 kg weight. And while it is pulling this, it is exerting 35,000 Newton force to the track. Now we have to find out net accelerating force and acceleration of the train. Just note down all the details given to us, that mass of the engine, it is going to be 8,000 kg. Mass of the wagons equals to 5 into 2000. So it is going to be 10,000 kg. Then it exerts 40,000 Newton force. Force equals to 40,000 Newton. And friction force equals to 5,000 Newton. This is all the details what we have. Now let us understand that how much force is exerted on the track. As I have shown the situation earlier, from that the force exerted by a train, the net accelerating force will be equals to, the force is 40,000 Newton and friction force is 5,000 Newton. So we need to subtract it. So force from the engine minus force of the friction force. So equals to 40,000 minus 5,000. So it is going to give us 35,000 Newton force. So this is going to be net accelerating force. Friction force we are subtracting from that. So that is net accelerating force. Now we have to find out acceleration of the train. So that we are going to get from F. F equals to M into A. This A will give us acceleration of the train. Force we have, mass we know that 8000 plus 10,000. So total mass what we are taking here is 18,000. So let us first write total mass. Total mass equals to 8000 kg plus 10,000 kg of wagon. So it is going to be 18,000 kg total mass. So that 18,000 kg we are going to put here. And force we know that it is 35,000 Newton. So A equals to F divided by M. F we know that it is 35,000 Newton divided by mass, that is 18,000 kg. So 1.944 meter per second square, because it is acceleration. So this is the acceleration for the train. So we got here two answers: net accelerating force and acceleration of the train. train. Eighth question is, an automobile vehicle has a mass of 1500 kg. What must be the force between the vehicle and road if the vehicle is to be stopped with a negative acceleration of 1.7 meter per second square? So what all details they have given? They have given us mass. They have given us mass of a vehicle. Then they are saying that eventually it is going to stop. It is going to stop. So final velocity of this is going to be zero. With a negative acceleration, this is negative acceleration, so they have given us acceleration here. Let us note down all the details. So here m equals to 1500 kg they have given. Then they are saying that it is going to stop, so final velocity what they have given is zero. Then they are saying that acceleration is equals to 1.7 meter per second square, and they are saying that this is negative acceleration. That means it is negative, so minus 1.7 meter per second square, because this is eventually going to stop. So acceleration is going to be negative. Now we need to find out the force. So force equals to what that we have to find out. Now we have here m and a, both of this we have. So our formula is going to be F equals to M into A. From in this, let us see the units are proper or not. So this is in kg and this is meter per second square. So yes, this is proper unit. This units are proper. So here we are going to get 1500 for mass, and acceleration is minus 1.7 meter per second square. So once we will multiply this, we will get here 2550 newton. This much force will be exerted, and this too minus. Why this is negative? Because this is going to be a friction force which will be applicable in opposite direction of the motion. So that's why this is negative. Our ninth question is, what is the momentum of an object of mass m moving with a velocity v? What is the meaning of momentum? Momentum we will get once the mass of the object will combine with the velocity. So momentum equals to mass of an object into velocity of the object. Momentum is a product of mass and velocity of that object. So here we are going to get mass of an object is m they have given. So that is m, and it is moving with velocity v. So that is v. So momentum we will get is equals to m into v. So here the D option is correct. That dmv is the correct, because momentum is a product of mass into velocity. So D option is correct here. Question number 10. Using a horizontal force of 200 newton, we intend to move a wooden cabinet across a floor at a constant velocity. What is the friction force that will be exerted on the cabinet? So one cabinet is there, and that we are trying to move across the horizontal floor, and we are applying force of 200 newton. We are applying force of 200 newton in the forward direction. In the forward direction, and they have said that we intend to move a cabinet with this much force. So how much friction force will be applicable on that from opposite direction? So how much ever force we are applying on that, that much force will come from the opposite direction. That much force will come from the opposite direction. Action and reaction forces are equal and opposite in their direction. So 200 newton force will be from the opposite direction. And since this is in forward direction, this is positive, this is in opposite direction of the motion, so this is going to be negative. So how much friction force? So here F equals to 200 newton. So the friction force is going to be 200 newton only, same as action. the reaction force will be there, but this will be in opposite direction, so it will be negative, that is minus 200 newton. Question number 11. Two objects, each of mass 1.5 kg, are moving in the same straight line but in opposite direction. So two objects are there. This is object 1 and this is a second object. Both are having 1.5 kg mass. Their mass are equal and they are traveling in opposite direction to each other. The velocity of each object is, their velocity is also equal, that is 2.5 meter per second. Here also it is 2.5 meter per second. Before the collision, during which they stick together. So after collision, when they will collide with each other, they will stick together. This object 1 and object 2, they both will stick together. What will be the velocity of combined object after collision? So after collision, this is the first situation. Then they are colliding. After colliding, they are stick together. So mass, we can get it from here, that 1.5 plus 1.5 will be the mass of this two object because they got stick together. So 3 kg mass will be there. But over here, what will be the velocity? What will be the velocity of this new object, or what will be the velocity of this two object once they stick together? So here, as per the third law of the motion or as per the law of conservation of mass, we can write a term like momentum before collision equals to after collision momentum. So before collision one term we will get and after collision one term will be get. So those two terms will be equal as per the law of conservation of mass. And from that we are going to find out the final velocity of this object. Now let us note down all the details. So M1, that is object 1, and that mass is 1.5 kg. Then the velocity of this first object, that velocity is going to be initial velocity of this object. So that is 2.5 meter per second. So this is initial velocity, that is before collision. Now M2, mass of second object is 1.5 kg. Now initial velocity of second object is 2.5 meter per second. Now they have said that they are traveling in opposite direction. So this is going to be negative because this is coming from the front and this direction of this object is opposite to this direction. So this initial velocity of the second object will be negative. Now as per the third law of motion and as per the law of conservation of mass, so here we are going to write, as per the third law of motion, before collision equals to after collision. Now what is the formula here? We know that it is M1 U1 plus M2 U2. Now after collision we will get M1 V1 plus M2 V2. But here after collision what is happening is both the object will stick together. So we are taking them combined and their velocity will be going to 1. So here after collision it is going to be M1 plus M2 because they both are stick together. So M1 plus M2 and their final velocity will be same. Now let us put all the values here, that 1.5 into 2.5, that is their initial velocity, plus 1.5 into minus 2.5 equals to, we will get here 1.5 plus 1.5. They are both objects mass and V. Now whatever answer we will get from this term and this term, both will be opposite. So this whole term is going to be zero because here minus sign is there. So both answer will be same and opposite in sign. So this whole term is going to be zero. So So 0 equals to 1.5 plus 1.5 is going to be 3 into b. So now when we are writing here v and 3 we are taking towards this side, opposite. So it is going to be there in denominator. Now v equals to 0 divided by 3. So here v equals to, we will get 0. V equals to, we will get 0. 0 meter per second. Why 0 meter per second? Because both objects are having same mass, both objects are having same velocity, but that too in opposite direction. So when two similar objects with same velocity, they will collide with each other, their net velocity will be 0. The net velocity will be 0. So after collision, they do not possess any kind of velocity. Question number 12. According to the third law of motion, when we push on an object, the object pushes back on us with equal and opposite force. If the object is a massive truck parked along the roadside, will probably not move. A student justifies this by answering that the two opposite and equal forces cancel each other. Comment on this logic and explain why the truck does not move. First of all, let us understand the situation. Truck is parked along the roadside. We are pushing it. It is not moving. Why? When this object will move? So the object will move only if whatever force we are giving, that should be more than its friction force. Because when we are moving any object, for example, this box, I am moving in this forward direction, my force should be such that it should overcome the friction force. So that is known as external unbalanced force. If my force will be less, then the friction force will be more and I'll not be able to move this. But the moment when my force will be more than the friction force. Now what is a friction force? Friction force is applicable along the surface and in that too in opposite direction. That too in opposite direction. So my force should be more than the friction force. It has to be unbalanced. So force and friction force, when they are equal, you cannot see that any work is happening or we can move anything. That will not going to happen because both of this will be opposite in their direction. But when whatever force I am applying will be more than the friction force, this is known as external unbalanced force. So at that time, I can move the box. I can move the box because my force has overcome the friction force. So in this situation, only the box will move. Now imagine a situation of a truck which is parked at the roadside. So until and unless we are pushing it with a more force which will be overcome the friction force, that truck is not going to move from that side. So how we are going to frame our sentence? That the object will move only if the force applicable on it will be greater than its frictional force or friction force. Friction force. Now what is a friction force? So friction force will be same as the force applied and opposite in direction. Here you can also say that magnitude. The magnitude of the friction force will be same as the force applied and opposite in direction. Truck will move only if we apply force greater than the friction force. Our force should be greater than the friction force, then only any object will be able to move or any object will move because our force will overcome the friction force. Until and unless it is balancing the force and it is balancing the friction force, we cannot see any movement in that box or in that truck. Question. A hockey ball of mass 200 gram traveling at 10 meter per second is struck by a hockey stick so as to return it along the same original path with a velocity at 5 meter per second. Calculate the magnitude of change of momentum occurred in motion of the hockey ball by force applied by the hockey stick. Now what is the situation here? This is a hockey ball of 200 gram. It is traveling in a certain direction. From there, it got struck by a hockey stick and it is traveling in a same direction back. in same direction back it is traveling back, and return it along the same original path with a velocity. So here velocity we know that it is 5 meter per second, and here the velocity with which it was traveling earlier was 10 meter per second. So what we have to find out, that a magnitude of change of momentum in this first situation and second situation. So from the first situation we will find out the magnitude, and from the second situation we will find out the magnitude. Then we will take a difference of that magnitude. So we will get to know that how much magnitude has been changed. Let us note down what all details they have given to us. Mass is 200 gram. So this 200 gram, we need to convert this into kg. So gram, we need to convert it into kg. From smaller unit, we are going to bigger unit. So divide here with 1000. So when we are going to divide this with 1000, we will get here 200 divided by 1000. So we will get here 0.2 kg. This is the mass for the ball. Now, the velocity when it is traveling in forward direction. So here initial velocity of this ball is going to be 10 meter per second, or when it is traveling in forward direction. Now same ball is returning along the same path. So in that situation, its velocity is going to be 5 meter per second. But at this time, its direction will be opposite, because it is traveling along the same path but into opposite direction. So this velocity is going to be negative. This velocity is going to be negative. Now from this we are going to find out the momentum, that initial momentum is going to be here m into u, because this is initial velocity. So we will get here 0.2 into initial velocity is 10. So we are going to get here 2. 2 will be the initial momentum, and the unit is going to be kg meter per second. Now we are going to find out final momentum. So for the final momentum, we are going to write m into v. So here 0.2 into 5, but that is going to be minus 5, because it is in opposite to this initial travel. So here we are going to get 1, and that too minus. So minus 1, and the unit is going to be kg meter per second. Now these two are the momentum. We have to find out the change in the momentum. So how to find out the change in the momentum? So change in the momentum equals to final minus initial. Final momentum minus initial momentum. So our final momentum is minus 1. And initial momentum is minus 2. So we are going to get here 3. 3, and this is a momentum. So unit will be kg meter per second. That too minus. So change in momentum will be minus 3 kg meter per second. That much will be the change in momentum occurred in the motion of the hockey ball when it go back along the same path. Fourteenth question. A bullet of mass 10 gram traveling horizontally with a velocity of 150 meter per second strike a stationary wooden block and comes to rest in 0.03 second. Calculate the distance of penetration of the bullet into the block. Also calculate the magnitude of force exerted by the wooden block on the bullet. So here this is a wooden block. Once we are firing a bullet from here, it will go with certain velocity. That velocity here is 150 meter per second. They have given the mass also. That mass is 10 gram. So with this much velocity, when it strikes to the wooden block, it will go and it will penetrate this wooden block. That means up till some distance it will get inside the wooden block. Up till some distance it will get inside the wooden block. So this distance we have to find out, that what will be this distance, that it will go and stuck into the wooden block. So how much distance it will go back? When it is traveling inside the wooden block, when it is going inside the wooden block, how much friction force will be applicable from the wooden block to the bullet? From the wooden block to the bullet, because it is penetrating inside a wooden block. So when it is going inside, how much friction force will be applicable from wooden block to bullet? So that will be in opposite direction of the motion, because bullet is going in while the friction force is will be applicable on opposite direction. Let us note down all the details given to us, that mass equals to 10 gram. Now mass is in a gram, we need to convert it into kg, so we need to divide it with 1000. So 10 divided by 1000, we are going to get here 0.01 kg mass of the bullet. After that, they are saying that traveling horizontally with a velocity of 150 meter per second strike a stationary wooden block and comes to rest. It is coming to rest after that. That means it is traveling and then comes to rest. So this is going to be its initial velocity. So u equals to 150 meter per second. And it is coming to rest, that means its final velocity is going to be 0 meter per second. Then in how much time it is coming to rest? T equals to 0.03 second. In this much time frame it is coming to rest. So what we have to find out? We have to find out distance and magnitude of force. So we have to find out S equals to what will it be, and F equals to what it will be. We need to find out. So S formula requires acceleration. T square minus u square equals to 2as. So for that we need to find out acceleration. So let us first find out the acceleration. That acceleration is v equals to u plus at. Now we know that v is 0, that is final velocity is 0 because it is coming to rest. Then u is 150. Plus A we need to find out into 0.03. So A equals to, we will get, when 150 we are taking towards this side, it is going to be minus 150. And 0.03 will go to its denominator. 0.03. So we can write like this, that minus 150 divided by 3, and in division 100 is there. Now this denominator's denominator will go to the numerator. So it is minus 150 divided by 3 in multiplication 100 divided by 1. 5s are 15 and it is 150, so here 50. 3 50s are 150, so here 50 into 100 we are going to get minus 5000 meter per second square. This much will be the acceleration for this situation. Since we know the acceleration, we can find out the distance. This distance equals to v square minus u square equals to 2as. V square is 0 minus u square is 150 square equals to 2 into acceleration is 5000, that is minus 5000 into s. Now here 22500 and that to minus equals to 2 into 5. We are going to get minus 10,000 from this multiplication and into S. So S equals to, we will get 22500 in denominator 10,000. Now at both the side negative sign is there. So negative negative will become positive. 225 divided by 100. So 2.25 meter will be the answer. 2.25 meter will be the answer, and that much distance it will travel inside the wooden block. That much distance it will travel inside the wooden block. Now this is our first answer. From this we have to find out that how much force will be exerted from the wooden block to the bullet. Now force equals to m into a, that is mass into acceleration. Mass here is 0.01 kg and acceleration we got is 5000 meter per second square. So here we are going to get 5000 into 1 in division 100. So we can cancel out two zeros. So here we are going to get 50. So this much force and this is going to be Newton. And that will be minus since this acceleration is negative. So this much friction force will be applicable from the wooden block to the bullet. And this negative sign will indicate that the friction force will be in opposite direction to that of the motion. Our 15th question is, an object of mass 1 kg traveling in a straight line with a velocity of 10 meter per second collides with and stick to stationary wooden block of mass 5 kg. So this object 1 is of 1 kg, is traveling in this direction and it has a velocity that is 10 meter per second. Now it is going and while going it is colliding with a wooden block and mass of that wooden block is 5 kg. Then both move off together in a straight line. They both will move off together in a straight line once they will collide with each other. Then they both move off together in a same straight line. Calculate the total momentum just before the impact and just after the impact. So before and after momentum we have to find out as per the third law of motion. And also calculate the velocity of combined objects. So here how much velocity they do have or they will possess after this collision, that we have to find out. So let us note down all the details given to us, that object 1, so it is going to be m1 equals to 1 kg. Then the velocity, that initial velocity of object is u1, that is 10 meter per second. Then it is going and colliding with the second object, so m2 is going to be 5 kg. Then we have to find out the final velocity of this object when they stick together and they are traveling. This final velocity we have to find out, and initial velocity for this object is going to be, that u2 is going to be 0 because it was stationary wooden block, it was stationary, but this object will go, it will move and it will collide with this block. So initial velocity of object 2, that is a wooden block, will be 0. Now from this detail we are going to find out the momentum impact, that is before collision equals to after collision. So as per the law of conservation of masses, before collision equals to after collision. So here before collision is going to be m1 u1 plus m2 u2. And after collision, they stick together. So it is going to be m1 plus m2 because now they are together and the velocity is going to be combined for them. So this is final velocity for both of them. Now let us note down all the values here, that 1 into 10 plus 5 into 0 because initial velocity of wooden block is 0. Now here let us write down mass 1 plus 5. And we do not know the V. This term is going to be 0 because 5 is in multiplication with 0. So here we are going to get 10 equals to 6V. So V equals to 10 by 6. We are going to get 2 divided by 3. We are going to get here 5 divided by 3 meter per second. We can divide this and we will find out that 5 divided by 3, 3 ones are 3. We will get here 2. Then again, we can put here 0 and here point. So we will get here 6 and 18. So this will go on and on. So 1.66 we can write. So the answer for the V is 1.66 meter per second. This much velocity will be there for this two object when they will combine and move forward. So this is the answer. Now calculate the velocity of the combined object. So this is a velocity, and calculate the total momentum just before the impact and after the impact. Here we have to find out the momentum. So what will be the momentum? Let us find out the momentum. So what is a momentum? Momentum is a product of mass into V. Momentum is a product of mass into V. So before collision, whatever momentum we will get is 1 into 10. So 1 into 10 we will get equals to 10 kg meter per second square. This much momentum is there. So this momentum, which is before collision, and after collision also we will get the same, because as per the law of conservation of momentum, before collision and after collision the momentum will remain same. So here calculate the total momentum just before the impact and after the impact. So in both the answer, before the impact and after the impact, the momentum is going to be same. You know the that velocity equals to 1.66. So here 1 plus 5, that is 6. So 6 into 1.66 if you will do, then it is going to give us approximately 10. So 10 equals to 10. So before collision and after collision momentum will remain same. Sixteenth question. An object of mass 100 kg is accelerated uniformly from a velocity of 5 meter per second to 8 meter per second in 6 seconds. So here they have given us mass of the object, then its velocity, and its velocity is changing from 5 meter per second to 8 meter per second. So there are two velocities in which it is changing from this to this. That means this is initial velocity, this is final velocity. In 6 seconds, that means this is the time given to us. Calculate the initial and final momentum. We have to find out momentum. Also find the magnitude of force. So we have to find out the force also from this situation, or which is exerted on the object. So let us note down all the details given to us. So M equals to 100 kg, mass of the object. Then velocity, 5 meter per second. So this is going to be initial velocity, and that is 5 meter per second. This is final velocity. So that is V equals to 8 meter per second. Time they have given, that is T, equals to 6 seconds. All the units are proper according to our formulas. Now we have to find out initial and final momentum. So what is the formula of momentum? Momentum is a product of mass and velocity. So when we are finding out initial momentum, we are going to use initial velocity. And when we are finding out final momentum, we are going to use final velocity. So first we are finding out initial momentum. Formula is m into velocity. So initial momentum, we are using initial velocity, m into u. So here 100 into 5, we are going to get 500. 500 kg meter per second. This is initial momentum. Now we are going to find out final momentum. So final momentum equals to m into final velocity. So that is going to be v. So here 100 into 8 equals to 800 kg meter per second. So we have found out here initial and final momentum. So these are two answers as per they asked. Now we have to find out the magnitude of force. That means we have to find out force, that how much force is exerted on the object. So what is the formula of the force? F equals to m into difference in velocity. So final velocity minus initial velocity divided by t. So m is 100, v is 8, u is 5, divided by t is 6. So here 100 into 3 divided by 6. So 3 2s are 6, and 2 50s are 100. So here we are going to get 50.
and since this is force, this is going to be Newton. So F equals to 50 Newton force will be exerted on the object. So these are our three answers. This is initial momentum, this is final momentum, and this is the third answer, that is force exerted on the object. Eighteenth question, how much momentum will a dumbbell of mass 10 kg transfer to the floor if it falls from a height of 80 cm? So here, object's mass is 10 kg and it is falling from the certain height. So height is 80 cm. Let us understand the situation that this is a dumbbell and it is falling from certain height. With acceleration equals to 10 meter per second square. And since it is falling from 80 centimeter height, that much distance it is covering. So height here is 80 centimeter and it is covering this much distance. While it is falling down, its acceleration is 10 meter per second square. But acceleration is in the direction of the motion where it is falling. So this is going to be positive. This is downward acceleration, so it will not be negative because it is in the direction of where the motion is. So acceleration is 10 meter per second square. Height is 80 centimeter. From there it is falling, so it is covering this much distance. So height we are taking as a distance. So that is S, this much distance it is covering. Now it has a mass of 10 kg. M equals to 10 kg. Since it is falling from the height, so it was at the resting position and then it is falling. So its initial velocity in this case is going to be 0. Initial velocity is going to be 0. Then what we have to find out? We have to find out momentum here. So momentum equals to M into V. That is a product of mass and velocity. We do not know the final velocity. To find out momentum, we need to find out final velocity. So from all these details, first we are going to find out final velocity, and from the final velocity we are going to find out momentum. Let us note down all the details. So M equals to 10 kg. Now it is falling from the height of 80 cm. Here how much distance it is covering, that is height. So height we are considering as distance covered. So that is S equals to 80 centimeter. Then acceleration is 10 meter per second square. Its initial velocity is going to be 0 because it was at resting position and then it has fallen down. Now let us first find out the final velocity. So we have the formula that 2as equals to v square minus u square. So we know 2a and s, we know u also, we need to find out the final velocity. So here, let us take this u towards this side. So it is going to be 2as plus u square equals to v square. So 2 into a is 10 into s is 80 centimeter. So we need to convert this into meter. So 80 centimeter. When we are converting it into meter, we need to divide it with 100. So it is going to be 0.8 meter. It is going to be 0.8 meter. So here we are taking 0.8 meter and then plus u square, which is going to be 0 equals to v square. When we will solve this out, we will get 20 into 0.8. So let us write this 20 into 8 divided by 10. 0.8 we have written as 8 divided by 10 equals to v square. So 10 2s are 20 and 16 equals to v square. So v equals to 4 meter per second. So this is a velocity. This is a velocity for this object when it is falling down, and this is positive. So momentum equals to m into v. Let us write down here mass, that is 10 kg. Velocity, what we found out here, that is 4. So momentum is going to be 40 kg meter per second. So momentum's answer is 40 kg meter per second. So this much is the velocity and this much momentum it will gain while it is falling down. In coming videos, we are going to discuss many important concepts. So don't forget to subscribe, learn yourself. I'll see you in next video. Till then, keep learning, keep sharing.